in your St. Matthew songbook or in your bulletin.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be you, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Our song of praise is on page 154 in your Alleluia 3 or in your bulletin, step by step.
I'm not afraid to die.
Let us pray. O God, the strength of all who put their trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers, and because in our weakness we can do nothing good without you, give us the help of your grace, that in keeping your commandments we may please you both in will and deed. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated.
The first lesson, Deuteronomy 30, 15 through 20. Moses said to all of Israel the words which the Lord commanded him. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you enter to possess. But if your hearts turn away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him and holding fast to him, for that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give you to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to you, Jacob. The word of the Lord.
Psalm 119, verses 1 through 8, responsibly by half verse. Happy are they whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Happy are they who observe his decree,
and seek him in all their hearts.
Who never do any wrong,
but always walk in his ways.
You lay down your commandments. My ways are made to so direct. Then I should not be put to shame.
I regard all your commandments.
I will thank you with an unprayed heart.
I have learned your righteous judgments.
I will keep your statutes.
Brothers and sisters, I could not speak to you as spiritual people, but rather as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for solid food. Even now you are still not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving according to human inclinations? For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, working together. You are God's field, God's building. The word of the Lord.
Our sequence song is The Power of Your Love, which is on page 6 in your St. Matthew songbook or in your bulletin. Please stand.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, 'You shall not murder,' and 'Whoever murders shall be liable to judgment.' But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, 'You fool,' you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great King. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Going to go ahead and admit that when I looked at the readings that the lectionary has provided for us, my first thoughts were, gee, I wonder if I can get someone else to preach. And then I started studying the readings, and that feeling didn't go away, so I started communicating with other priests and found out that they had the same feelings I did. And so here I am. This morning at 8:30, as I stood in the midst of the congregation reading the gospel lesson, I could actually hear people around me going, during the reading. At 11 o'clock, they didn't make the sounds, but you could still feel the tension. This is an uncomfortable gospel lesson. And I'll be honest, I don't know exactly what to do with it. Although I do think I have a couple of ideas about what not to do with it. There are some people out there who think that what's going on here is that Jesus makes everything so difficult that nobody could possibly live up to it, and therefore we all just get a free pass. And I'm pretty sure that that's not what Jesus is up to. There are things in life that are sinful and they need to be named as such. On the other hand, there are people who take this passage and use it as a source of great personal guilt. Those of us who have to hear confessions from time to time have all had to at some point in time suffer through that laundry list of every impure and unclean thought that somebody has ever thought they might have had. And I don't think that's what Jesus is about either. That sort of scrupulosity is also sinful because it shuts out any possibility that we ourselves might be what God has called us, and that is good. So the truth has to be somewhere in the messy middle. Somewhere between a get out of jail free card and a you're going to jail forever card. Something a lot less clear-cut. I find myself wondering if the key to understanding this gospel passage is to step back from it and get away from the details. Jesus stands in the tradition of Moses, in the tradition that was read to us from the book of Deuteronomy, a tradition giving us a choice between life and death. Now, at first glance, that sounds like a pretty clear-cut binary choice. All one way or all the other. But we all know that the choice of life is a messy one. You know, there's a reason why sociology is harder than physics, because physics gets to follow nice, clear mathematical formulas in a straight line, and sociology follows human life, and human life never runs in a straight line and usually forks off and has multiple tendrils out there. Life is not just the opposite of death, and in fact, it ends up including death in many, many forms. The choice is between clear-cut and messy. We often take rules and reduce them down to checklists. Right, there's the list over here of all the things that are good. There's the list over here of all the things that are bad. And I put my checks in the appropriate boxes, and as long as the tally sheet over here is longer, then I come out okay. But that's not what the law of God is supposed to be about. That choice between life and death is a choice between this easy, non-grown-up checklist and the difficult messiness of life in relationship. A life formed by love. Formed by the love of the one who made us. Formed by the love that we give back. Rules are supposed to point us toward that love. And I think that that's what Jesus is getting at in our gospel lesson. Similarly, Paul gives us this idea of milk and solid food. This idea of, well, we learn the rules, but then we learn what to do with them. Sat down on the steps of the altar today with the kids, and we talked about all of the rules they have to follow in their day-to-day lives. And we talked about also how that those rules aren't the end point, but rather the beginning. You start out learning the rules, and then you don't have to listen to the rules quite so much because what the rules are trying to teach you takes over. Jesus is speaking to people who have taken the law of God and turned it into a checklist. And so I think that by pushing us as far as he does with all of these saying, well, it's not just murder, but anger and all of these other things. What he's trying to do is move us away from just thinking about what's right and wrong in simplistic terms and move us into that adult space, into that solid food phase of recognizing that it's always about relationship, that it's always about living out the love of God. The rules fall away not because the things that they're telling us to do or not do are unimportant, but because we simply don't need the rules when we're really loving. When we're really loving, our first desire will be to do no harm. When we're really loving, our first desire will be to build up. And then you don't have to go through the checklist anymore. The rules are supposed to be training wheels that help us get to that place of love. Now that's a lot more uncomfortable than just being able to go through the checklist, because it puts an awful lot of responsibility on us. It becomes more difficult. And it means that we have to be holy in the game and not just tentatively or superficially there. But that is indeed what the law of God is about. The entirety of Scripture is a testimony to the God who gives one great big giant yes to us. A yes that finds its fullest expression on the cross. And then we're asked to give a yes back. Not just a yes to following the rules, but a yes to being holy, completely, fully in love with God and with one another. Please stand. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten.
Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you
in thought, word, or deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may
may Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you. Good evening, everyone. Two quick announcements while the band gets itself set back up. The first is that Jason Glasgow has informed me that we still have a couple of slots left for the mission trip to Honduras, and that the company that helps us organize that has extended our deadline by 2 weeks. And so if anybody has thought about going to Honduras but hasn't made up their mind yet, and you still think that that might be something that you want to do, I encourage you to speak with Jason promptly to see if that might be a possibility. And we announced this morning some bittersweet news. You might know that our youth minister, Sarah Gallion, is also pursuing ordination in the Lutheran Church. And because of that, she has been splitting her time every Sunday between here and the Church of the Messiah here in town. And the Church of the Messiah offered her a position as youth minister, meaning that she does not have to split her time, and she has accepted it. This is a very good thing for Sarah and her family, and it's a sad thing for us. But Leanne and I are hard at work coming up with both short-term and longer-term plans for keeping youth ministry here at St. Matthew's alive and well. If one of us calls you to ask for some help, I encourage you to say yes to help us go. We're not going to ask any of you to be the youth minister. Do not worry about that. But we might ask you for a little bit of help here or there until we get somebody else in place. If you see Sarah or you get a chance to contact her, please thank her for all of the hard work she has done with us here at St. Matthew's. She's been a marvelous colleague for me and for the rest of the staff. She has been wonderful with our kids, and we've been blessed to have her. And I also know that there will be good things ahead for us in youth ministry wherever God is taking us next. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Made fair.
Please stand. All things come of thee, O Lord.
And of thine own have we given thee.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, the God-bearer, with blessed Matthew, our patron, and with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And as our Savior Christ has taught us, we now sing, Of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food
of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful
May Christ, the Son of God, be manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Our closing song is Take to the World, which is in your bulletin.
Thank you.
go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.